glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. You captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Oh, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. You captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Your glory. Lord, you capture my heart and you rapture my soul with your glory. Lord, you capture my heart and you rapture my soul with your glory. Lord, you capture my heart and you rapture my soul with your glory. Would you capture my heart and you capture my soul with your glory. So I will rejoice in the Lord. We shout to pray. Thanksgiving. rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, yes, I will rejoice in you, Lord. Oh, always, yes, I will rejoice in you, Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in you, Lord. The mighty God, the great I am. Alleluia, alleluia.
You are the mighty God, the great I am. Alleluia, alleluia. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, you are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, you are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, you are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, you are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah.
Almighty, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, wiser than the wisest, older than the oldest, greater than the greatest, Almighty God. You are wiser than the wisest, older than the oldest, greater than the greatest, Almighty God. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, you the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. Exalted higher than the heavens, high and lifted up, your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Oh, you're exalted in the heavens. You're high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Oh, you're exalted in the heavens. You're high and lifted up. Ah, your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Oh, you are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Oh, and your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Oh, you are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. All your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. Ha ha! You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come.
You are exalted in the heavens. You're high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are exalted in the heavens. Oh, yes. High and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the mighty, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, I'm going to say something strange, but just follow with me for just a minute. You know, there are many people that don't really even recognize the new year. They just think the things are going to be just the same as they've always been. It's a wonder they even changed the date. It's a wonder they even moved from 2016 to 2017. Because of them, it's just another ordinary, every old day, carrying the same issues, the same problems, the same burdens. But all of that's not true. God, in His loving kindness and tender mercy, has set an open door before us. He's given to us His mercies that are new every morning. He said before the wicked and most vilest men, and also before the most holy and the most righteous men, an opportunity to be forgiven. That opportunity is there always, every second of the day. An opportunity to be made brand new. But here's the problem. The expectation of many people's lives that nothing is going to change. The expectation is they look around and they judge everything based upon the five senses, and they think, well, you know, I still look the same. It's still the same reflection in the mirror. I still have the same hair issues. I still have the same clothes issues. Fine. I look at the bank account. Nothing changed about my bank account. I still got the same angry, grumpy boss. I still got the same whatever. All the various different things that people have, that there are their big problems. The Lord has set an open door before you. And I'm going to talk to you this morning about this. So I want you to just go ahead and be seated. Say, you are the mighty God. Is He? The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, we're singing a song that was written by Pastor Ed DuBois. And he had this really small little church in Africa, in Nigeria, with a bunch of poor people. And he set himself to break past his denomination, Church of God, to break past the ideas about who Jesus is, to break past the ideas about how God moves. He set himself to fasting and praying and seeking the Lord. Suddenly, after a considerable period of time, it wasn't overnight, it wasn't in a year, but after a considerable period of time of setting his heart before the Lord, all of a sudden, Jesus showed up. He made a transition from a common, ordinary, everyday human life to realizing, wait a minute, there's a door open before me, and I can step into a heavenly realm greater than what he knew. And he was a wonderful man of God, loved the Lord with all of his heart, well-educated, doctorate degree in mathematics, accomplished for a Nigerian. But there was something he wanted more than just what could be afforded to him in an everyday kind of a life. He heard an invitation from heaven that you could know Jesus, that you could walk in him, that you could live in him, that you could have a heavenly existence right now. He stepped in the realm, this glory, and all of a sudden, all kinds of signs and wonders and miracles started happening, and a new phenomenon has taken place that never existed in the earth before. His church is 1.8 miles by 1.8 miles square. No, no, no. 1.8 miles. When the altar call is given, there's 7 altars. If you start running when he first gives the altar call and you're a good sprinter, he'll give you 10 to 15 minutes to make it to the nearest altar. Is hundreds of thousands of people inside, hundreds of thousands of people outside. You know, I was watching one of his meetings, and they were just announcing that during the meeting, there was, I think it was like 37 children were born. They were telling how many boys were born, how many girls were born. Because when you have that many people gathered together, you got over 1 million people gathered together, you can have a lot of events taking place. This is church. What happened? I believe that when God's people will be willing to go ahead and move past all of the things that seem to be allowed, the mixtures, our entertainment, our fascination with really what is worldly, which people don't want to hear. And that's why churches who preach on holiness and consecration are rather small. But that's going to change.
Amen.
It's going to change, because the reason it's going to change is those who are preaching on holiness and consecration are going to step into a realm with the Lord Jesus Christ, and suddenly people are going to begin to experience a greater manifestation of his divine power and glory. You know, we were singing a song this morning that my son was given by the Holy Spirit, Captivated. You know, you've raptured my heart. You've raptured my heart. You captured me by your presence. And you know, my heart is set like never before. My heart is fixed. I've been pastoring for almost 34 years. And I could sit back and I could say, oh, look at what God did here. Look at what God did there. Look at the things. You know, I could say, well, I could make an excuses for myself and say, well, if I go overseas, I have a special assignment there. And so we have tens of thousands of people come in the meeting. But if I'm in the United States of America, it's just a few. And I could point to people like T.L. Osborne, who had the same crisis. I could talk about Tommy Hicks, who had the same crisis. He'd go overseas. He'd have hundreds of thousands of people in the meeting. He'd come to the United States of America, and it was great if he had 20 or 30. It's fine. I could make excuses for myself. But reality of it is, I recognize that Father has something for us that eclipses all the things that we believe are barriers and limitations.
Amen.
And he begins with giving us a new heart and a new spirit. But we have a problem with this hot concept of a new heart and a new spirit, because we're always remembering all the things that we did, all the failures, and especially, I'm going to tell you what you remember most of all, more than your failures, what people did against you. All the abuses you feel that you had, all the disappointments, all the discouragements, everything that everybody ever did you wrong, because you can blame somebody for every problem you've ever had. And that kind of lets you off the hook, you know. You don't feel as bad about yourself. And everybody's trying to feel better. Nobody likes pain. You run from the pain. But the Lord has brought to us the gospel message of I release you. I forgive you. I don't remember it no more. And guess what? He doesn't want us to remember it anymore either. I want to read a few verses of scripture to you. I just try to help you understand these things. And I want to start off and just get you captivated by really what's set before us. What's the opportunity? Jesus is the door. And if you look to start with in John chapter 8, you'll hear him say this. He says, I'm the door. I'm the way you enter in. I'm the entrance. Would you like to come in to a whole nother realm? A whole nother realm of existence. Not a fairy tale, not a fantasy. And I'm going to tell you right now, when you are willing to respond, your bank account isn't going to change. Your reflection in the mirror isn't going to change. All the mess and stuff that you've got yourself into surrounding you isn't going to change. The external is not going to change, but your heart and your perspective on it is all going to change. And that heart and that perspective on it that changes, all of a sudden will begin to rearrange everything in your life. It'll begin to rearrange every circumstance you have, unless you falter. You can falter. You can weary in well-doing. You can begin to become overwhelmed and say, no, nothing's really changed. And now you go back to the realm of the five senses of what you think you know, what humanity teaches you, what secularism poses upon you. Or you can refuse all of that and say, no, I want to come over here and I want to walk in this revelation that has been given to me by the Word of God and by the Spirit of God to open doors before me. There is a real realm there. I want to press it and get it. And not only do I have so many witnesses in the Bible, I've got everyday, modern-day witnesses of things that are new, happening, that have never been seen before on the earth today, right now, just like amen. Pastor Adeboy.
Yes, amen.
Just like Pastor Adeboy. Never been heard before. You know, we could talk about, well, it was never heard before what Reinhard Bonnke did, where all of a sudden, and I've been on the platform with Reinhard Bonnke, in Reinhard Bonnke's meetings, I'm telling you, it was estimated 800,000 people there, and I would have thought there was a whole lot more. Well, a friend of mine and I were on the platform, and I said, listen, I said, Rodney, come on, man. I said, let's walk to the back and see what this place looks like. There's 800,000 men and women and children there, and we were the only people with white skin. And we started this pilgrimage, and if you know, it's just so thick and crowded. We got all the way to the back, and it was, I don't know, it was close to a mile. And Reinhardt looked about that big on the platform, but his speakers were so big we could hear him very plainly. That was an amazing, a miraculous thing that had never taken place before. Never. And we have so many things like that where God is doing amazing things, but people choose to ignore it. Satan chooses to hide it. He chooses to amplify and make big to you your issues, your problem, and what some, you know, person is saying that is an antichrist, anti-God person. And then we have, once again, as I said, here all of a sudden, this man, Adeboye, steps into this anointing power of God, signs and wonders and miracles. Somebody said he fasted and prayed till he bled. Well, you know what? That's okay. Forget about it. He laid hold on God, because I tell you right now, you start fasting, you're going to find out prayer comes a lot easier to you.
Amen.
It's true. It just comes. It's just a flow. There's a lot of times people are just trying to, they don't understand. They try to pray, nothing happens. It's because opposed upon them is all of their agreements with their former life. All of the agreements and allowances to things that are being placed upon us and imposed upon us that should never be allowed. God delivered us through Christ Jesus from every sin and every sickness and every disease and brought us into a realm of heaven, a realm of glory. He said, I am the open door. An open door is set before you, he says to the church in Revelation 3:8. An open door is set before you. He tells us in John chapter 10, he says, I am the truth. I am the way. I am the life. I am the door. If anybody wants to have a great life, an abundant life, which is God trying to describe to us a life that goes beyond description. You want an eternal kind of life, that's the God kind of life. It's not something that's in the future. It's something that we get to possess now when we call upon the name of the Lord and we say, come save me. He's a savior. He's a deliverer. He's the one who releases us from our prison. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me so I can release you from your prison. So the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach to everybody who's willing to listen, and that's usually poor people.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah.
who don't have a bunch of other things to trust in. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. What is the good news? The day of your captivity is over. You're released from all your mess. You're released from all of your stuff. You're released from all of your sin. You're released from everything that imposes itself upon you, that demands of you to be a little, almost clone, if you would, of that which is wrong. And always making the wrong decisions and just following a herd that is going in the wrong direction. He said, I've come to deliver you. He said, wait a minute. And then they try to just steal this and try to understand this in the context of their religion and what they believe they know about God and what they've understood in the past. And then the Lord says, I want you to understand a totally different new thing. I want you to understand a new thing. Behold, I set before you an open door. It's a new beginning. It's a new way. It's everything that the prophet Isaiah talked about in Isaiah chapter 42. When the Lord said, I do a new thing in the earth, and it's going to spring up quickly. And it's all about him laying before us that we're released from every form of darkness and every form of evil and every form of ungodliness and every form of wickedness that is imposed upon us. People don't equate sin to their problems, but I'm going to tell you right now, it is absolutely equated. You show me people who've learned how to walk with the Lord, I'm going to show you people who learn how to walk in happiness. Amen. See, really, that's all the gospel is. Hey, would you like to be happy? I mean, happy all the time, because all the decisions you're going to make is going to make you sad. And your way is going to make you sad, but if you'll come, I'll deliver you and I'll give you the ability to walk with me. Because until you're delivered, you can't walk with me. You won't have the ability to walk with me. You'll always go back. You'll always go back to the wrong decisions. And you can't walk in happiness. He calls it joy unspeakable. But I just want to break it down for people because they've made that some kind of a religious notion. I want to say happy. I get to be happy all the time. Somebody says, really? No, I'm truly happy. It's like, oh, Lord, this is amazing. That's called abundant life. And it has nothing to do with whether or not what clothes I have or what kind of things I have or what my bank account is, because my bank account is usually upside down. Why? Because I'm doing things that go way beyond my own human means, personal means. Huh? I'm doing God's business, and that costs lots of money. But he's got lots of it to give. I just walk in a realm of just trusting him. Somebody said, aren't you stressed out? Aren't you pressured? No, I'm in the midst of something so wonderful and so good. Amen. And it's being a God-made man instead of a self-made man. Amen. Last night, people rejoiced and celebrated themselves. I shouted before the Lord with praise and thanksgiving for what he's done, the new year. That's what he's done. This is what he's given. I praised him for his mercies that were new every morning to me and extended to me and his keeping power this whole last year and all the great opportunities, the things that he's calling me into this next year with all of his blessings, with all of his protection, with all of his provision. Come on, man. There's nothing that the Lord won't deliver you out of. Jesus came. He was manifested to destroy the works of the devil, and we got to watch what he did. He found people tormented and he delivered them from their torments. So torment's not the will of God. It's the enemy of God and the enemy of God's creation. It is a plague. It's worse than thorns and briars and it's worse than any other thing that you would see in the realms of the demonic. Torment, fear. He came to deliver us from fear. He saw somebody who was in sin. He said, your sins are forgiven you. He released them from their sins because he came to destroy the works of the devil. And sin is a work of the devil. And he saw somebody sick and diseased over and over again. And he delivered them from their sickness and delivered them from their diseases. When people were upset, hey, who are you to forgive sin? He says, and you tell me, is it easier just to say something or is it easier to do a work of power? So he said to the man who had forgiven their sins, proving that he is the power to forgive sins, and he's the one who forgives it, releases it, doesn't leave you in it, doesn't just forgive you, and now you're still stuck with the same problems. He releases you. He forgives you. He remembers it no more. He releases you from the stronghold and the bondage of it. You get liberated. You get to go free. You don't have to be addicted anymore.
Come on. You don't have to be trapped anymore. You don't have to be plagued by the failure of it anymore. You don't have to be harassed by the condemnation of it anymore. You are released from its power. He was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. He says, I'm the door. I'm the doorway into an entirely different existence. Why aren't God's people willing to go ahead and make the full step, make the full conversion? They come halfway. They come to the meeting. They call upon the name of the Lord. They do certain things, but they're not willing to make the full transition. Mm-hmm. The domination of the five senses, the sight, the hearing, what you believe, what you were told. Everything that you believe right now, your perceptions are really based upon what you were taught. Amen. Everything you believe right now, you were conditioned to believe it. Preschool, grammar school, you were conditioned. And I can prove it. We can prove it over and again sociologically. We can take you out into the jungles of the Congo and you're not going to even be related to the people because they have been conditioned to believe and perceive things in an entirely different way. I can take you into the jungles of Irian Jaya or Papua New Guinea. It's an entire, you can't even relate to them. You can go into the jungles of the rainforest and the deep parts of the rainforest in Brazil, and you're not going to even be able to relate to the way that they think, the way they perceive life. You're going to think they're ignorant. They're going to think you're ignorant. You're going to think they're seeing things and they're going to think you're really seeing things. You believe what? You believe that's the way it works? Come on. The Lord says, listen, I'm going to deliver you from all that trap. I'm going to deliver you from all those things that you think and all those things that you think life exists by. I want to deliver you from the way that you perceive things. I want to teach you a whole new way. I want you to see that there are more with you than are with them. I want your eyes to be open. I want you to know me. I want you to behold me. I want you to behold the splendor of all that I have for you. I want you to begin to live a life instead of in curses, in blessings, to be blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. I want you to have your citizenship in heaven. I want you to have your lifestyle in heaven. I want you to know I give you authority to walk in this realm of sonship. This is what the Lord's saying to us over and again. But yet we still recline back to this place of what we can do and what the system says that we're supposed to do. And yeah, I know that's what God said, but we've got to go to work and we've got to make money. And then we begin to allow everything about this world system to be our source. There's nothing wrong with going to work, and there's nothing wrong with being responsible, and there's nothing wrong with seeing a financial blessing come to you. But you're going to have to start recognizing, wait a minute, that isn't something that is a provision that's come to you by the works of your own hands. That is a miraculous provision of God. All of a sudden, God becomes God in your life. He's the one who gave that to you. All of a sudden, he becomes a protector, the provider, the perfecter. And now everything begins to change because you were willing to come into the door, step in the door and say, now God rules over my life. Nothing can happen to me. Nothing's bigger than God. Somebody said, there's no way you can have this property with 80,000 square feet of building and 6 acres of land. But God says yes. And so everybody has to say yes too. They don't know why they're saying yes, but they got to say yes.
Right.
And if I told you how much we pay for this on a monthly basis, you would even be more surprised because God said yes and everybody else has to say yes too. People are always asking me, how is it you get so lucky with property? You had all that property down there on Harbor and Rosecrans, you know, those many, many acres and, you know, tens of thousands of square foot of building. Because God says yes. And everybody else has to say yes too. Why? Because I made a transition not to look at my finances to make my decisions anymore, not to look to my own arm, not to look to my own ability to arrange things or manipulate things. Yeah. Suddenly God became the source. He was the one who gave me the paycheck, not a man, not a company. God gave that to me. And so I started learning how to let God be the one who's ruler over my life, provider. I started living in his kingdom. And suddenly I begin to enjoy a greater dimension of unrestriction in his kingdom to where that I could step out and say, oh yeah, well, we need $100,000 to do that crusade over there. Or we need this $1 million to get this. Where are you getting that money? What, you think money grows on trees? No, I think it's just supplied by God.
Amen.
I think it's supplied supernaturally by the Spirit of the Lord. And money's a big thing to all of us. Most people's offenses and problems are actually centered around money. Somebody cheated them. Somebody gave them a raw deal. Somebody did. Now they lent money and didn't get paid back. It's crazy how much money rules men. and you can't serve God and mammon. And he said, Jesus, I'm a door. I'm going to get you out of mammon. Come on, get you out of mammon. Come on, I'm going to get you out of mammon. We're sitting there going. Suddenly, you don't need lawyers anymore? Because God's your defense? Suddenly, you don't need doctors anymore? Because he's your healer? I'm not saying you can't go to doctors and you can't go to lawyers. Help yourself. If that's what you want, help yourself. Oh, don't talk condescending to me. Well, get over your pride and arrogance. Huh? Because I'm going to tell you right now, God's a better lawyer than any lawyer ever been born. He's a better doctor than any doctor that's ever been born. How you, come on, suddenly, you don't need bodyguards anymore? Jesus didn't have one bodyguard. I mean, Peter, one time. And he got beside himself. He was trying to prove to Jesus that he wasn't going to forsake him. Huh? He was being a big man in the crowd. But as soon as he got isolated by himself, the true colors came out. I don't know the man. And he swears by an oath by God. But there's someone who's there with mercy and forgiveness that Peter was able to reach out and take, and he could have a new beginning. And it was never held against him and never will be held against him for all eternity, though we talk about it. We still talk about Peter's sin. Man, I'm glad mine's not so public. How about you? Huh? Yeah. Because when we talk about Peter's sin, we also get to talk about God's mercy.
Yeah. Amen.
Because look at what God did through him. He didn't hold him back at all. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. I'm going to just read a few verses of scripture to you here. I mentioned and referred to and even quoted some parts of John chapter 10. So just let me get you to turn over there so you know how to refer to your notes. Then Jesus said to them, with absolute certainty, I tell you, I am the door of the sheep. None of us get to come to God but by the Lord Jesus Christ. None of us are allowed in to his realms of glory, to his realms of joy, to his realms of love, to his realm of peace, which is all that which he is separated into. See, we define God's holiness simply because he defines holiness as his separation unto his life. He's never going to go into hate. He's going to stay in love. He's never going to go into worry or judgment or, worry or condemnation. He's going to stay in peace. He's never going to go over into a realm of condemnation. He's going to stay in peace. He's never going to go over into a realm of sadness and sorrow. He's going to stay over in joy. He's consecrated to the realms of life. He's never going to step outside of his righteousness, in other words, his conduct, his nature, his character. Jesus said, I'm the way into that. Nobody's ever been, it's been proven over and again, no man can come in there since Adam rebelled against God and sinned and committed high treason against the kingdom. But now I'm the way in. Man was thrust out from the presence of the Lord, and now a doorway's been opened into the realms of the supernatural, into the realms of the heavenly, into the realms of entirely new life. That's what this Bible says. That's what Jesus declared. He said, I am the door. He said, all that ever came before me, everyone that ever came before me, somebody said, how about other religions? How about other beliefs? He said, they're thieves and robbers. Mm-hmm. You know? Somebody said, well, if Jesus is truly the Messiah, why did the Jews reject him? Hey, that's an easy answer. I can show you proof after proof after proof that they rejected every prophet God ever sent. Why should Jesus be any different? Hello. And somebody said they're so brilliant and so bright. Well, maybe so brilliant and so bright, but rejected every prophet that God ever sent. Everyone from Moses all the way through. Give me a break. I mean, why aren't they going to reject Jesus? They rejected John the Baptist. Bottom line of it is, that's just men trapped within their own religion. And people reject what I'm saying right now because they're trapped within their own religion. They don't believe that God truly is God. He's a supreme figurehead somewhere out there in the galaxies in the far beyond. But that's not God. He's here.
Amen.
He's living.
Amen.
He's not some supreme being. Amen. Huh? He is a sovereign, almighty, nothing breathes, nothing moves except he allows it. He's the creator of all things. He ordained and decreed everything. And look at what he's decreed for you and me in this new life, in this abundant life. Look at the price he paid when Jesus poured out his blood. I mean, sometimes I've thought, you know, he was wounded for my transgressions is an entire understatement.
Amen.
It's the biggest understatement ever. He was tortured. He was tortured for my transgressions. He was chastised, which really grabs a hold of torture more than anything else. A scourged, chastised. He was tortured. That chastised word can actually be translated tortured for my peace. He provided a means for you and I to be cleansed from every stain of sin and released from every stronghold and every of Satan, every tyrannical activity of the demonic, by supplying to us his blood at a great cost. He had a crown of thorns, lashes that we can't even begin to imagine, a piercing of his body by the nails on Calvary's tree and by a spear in his side, to supply to us, to convince us of his love, to supply to us the means that every one of our sins would be erased, every bit of judgment upon sin was fully paid, so that you and I could be released from the past and not carry the past into the future. Many people are going to still remember what their spouse did to them, you know, 30 years ago. Could you stop it? Because you're a prisoner. You don't get to go on with God. You don't get to go on to his blessings because you're holding yourself in a place of sin and offense and unforgiveness. You're holding yourself in the old. God wants you to come into the new. He says, jump ship off the old and quit running, you know, run the boat around in circles because the scenery is old, and hop on this new ship. Hop on this new life. Everything is going to be new, and every day it's new, and every day God unfolds to us something beautiful and wonderful. You know, most of my life I gave myself to study, to academics. I love learning. I mean, people look at me and say, man, you have got some serious issues. I mean, you want to learn all the tissues of the body. You want to learn, you want to learn every muscle, every nerve, you know, every fiber. You want to learn, you know, you like molecular biology. Are you out of your mind? You're doing textual criticism. You like studying languages. What is your problem? I love learning new things. It is beautiful to learn, but, you know, ornithology, just study of birds or whatever. It's just so beautiful. Every place you look in God's creation, it unfolds to you a whole nother universe of beauty and amazement. Wow, you got to be kidding me. I was learning reproductive science, and I was standing over the shoulder of a guy who was there, and we were doing in vivo fertilization, and there's the zona pellucid on the embryo. I said, tell me there's not a sunshine of the living God on everything that moves. Huh? He said, something. That's all he said. It's something. Poor guy, he's stuck in his something. I'm just fascinated by the glory of God, because I can take that embryo, I can hold it and put it, I can freeze it in such a way, and I can hold it for years, throw it out, put it into an animal like a cow, and immediately it will start its growth again. And then I'll watch as this baby fully developed calf comes out, and it's just a wonder. It's miraculous. And Father said, no. I have something way better to show you.
Come on.
I got something. You got to get off your old way of thinking, though. All your mindset, you just all caught in, you know, this trap of blame game and how somebody didn't do you right and how you wish you had more money and, you know, and all. And you wish you had more things. You wish you had more friends. And all you're doing is finding yourself in a whirlpool of strife and envy and anger and covetousness and unforgiveness. My, what a life. Ah! What a life. The gospel is, would you like to be happy? I'll give you happiness, and I'm the only source of it. Go look around. Go look around. Go look around. Let me just say real loud. Take some notes. Are you telling me everybody decided to be unhappy because that's what they wanted? No, they in slavery. They in bondage. They in darkness. They under the authority of a tyrannical rule of sin and iniquity. And not a sane person on this life who wouldn't want to be happy every second of the day. And there's laws to being happy every second of the day. There's spiritual laws. And you don't get to participate until you get a new heart and a new spirit. And you start thinking new. And you start living new. And you say, away with the old. It's not coming back. Stop, old. Stop. You not coming over here. I don't want your sorrow. I don't want your sadness. I don't want your misery. I don't want your grief. I don't want your pain. I don't want your poverty. I'm staying over here. I'm staying up here, and I'm going to do what God tells me to do. When people get upset at me, I'm going to respond out of humility and brokenness and say, forgive me. Sorry, I don't understand what you're saying, but, you know, listen, it'll be all right. Huh? Amen. Where you just give yourself over to love. And every time you're involved in a situation, people, hey, you love them back. So I said, that's ridiculous. No, that's how to be happy.
Amen.
That's how to be happy. Oh, can't we? Don't we need to fight? Yeah. If all you got you, get yourself the biggest cannon you can find. But when you got God, I'm going to tell you right now, I feel sorry for all your enemies. I feel sorry for them. I'd start praying for them right now. I mean, it's been proven over and again what God does to the enemies of his people. Are you listening to me? But you've got to step into another realm called faith, where you see this as a reality, where you step beyond just trying to believe something, where you step beyond the fantasies of religious ideologies and philosophies, and now you have a living relationship with a living God.
Come on.
There's a lot of things to have to bust past to have that. In many respects, God comes, delivered us. Jesus is the open door. He says, come in. But you know what? You and I have been trained all of our life to believe in this and believe in that and think it works this way and think it works that way. Don't work that way at all. Don't work that way at all. Just wait for the next edition to come out. You discover it didn't work that way at all. Oops, we made a mistake. Salt's good. No, now it's bad. Now it's good again. Egg's good. No, now it's bad. Now it's good again. I mean, just a few things. Now we're not sure whether it's good or bad. No, it's good. No, it's bad. Think about it, people. You and I live victims every day to men's lust and greed. The food chain system here in the United States, the supply system for food, it's all based upon making lots and lots of money. And so it is done in the worst kind of ways. It's produced in the worst kind of ways, in the most toxic ways, just so people can make money. We're being victimized all the time. You don't even realize it. But I'm not concerned about it. I'll pray over the thing, all the bad stuff goes out. Huh? And then I can throw in on being a part of producing things that are good, the way that God intended for them to be produced, and help people understand how to do agriculture correctly, how to do animal husbandry correctly, and other things. So food is a very important part of our life. You know what? You're constantly eating also things of the Spirit. You're constantly receiving things spiritually, and it's just, and what's happened is what men are supplying within the framework of the spiritual is more toxic than the food. See, the Lord says, listen, I got a new place. You can come under my governorship. I'm actually, Jesus right now, he said, I'm actually the sovereign ruler of everything. I rule over everything. My throne has been exalted. My kingdom has already been started. Huh? True. Huh? Unto us a son is given, unto us a child is born. His name should be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. At the increase of his government, there should be no end. He's not going to be exalted King of Kings and Lord of Lords in the future. He was exalted King of Kings and Lord of Lords 2,000 years ago. Somebody said, well, if he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, why is there still all the murder and all the crisis and all the ugliness and all the sin and all the iniquity? Because God's still giving people an opportunity to choose, and he is sorting it all out and dividing as the wheat is divided from the chaff. People are choosing constantly if they want to walk in sin and iniquity, and they want to walk in that crisis, because everybody knows that there's a lot of bad stuff going down and it ain't right. And God agrees with you. Now you need to start agreeing with him of why it's not right. And when you start agreeing with them of why it's not right, you'll find a Savior and you'll find a Deliverer. And once you find a Savior and once you find a Deliverer, and you know, wow, he really exists, then all of a sudden there's going to be hunger and thirst in your life to really get to know him, because he's amazing.
Amen.
Amen. This should be how the journey goes. This should be how the progress goes in our life. By his supernatural love, we are instantaneously born again and made a new creation. All things are new. Behold, old things are passed away. Who does that? Think about it. Who really goes all the way with the Lord and just does what he's decreed? And I just quoted a verse of scripture there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. He said, behold, all things are new. Old things are passed away. He's looking for you and I to agree with him. Everything's new. I'm living with the authority as a son of God over all sin, sickness, and disease. Hello, the only way I'm going to be a prisoner of it is somehow I'm entrapped by the fear and the influence of the demonic. That's it. And that presses against a sword, because it prints in the power of the atmosphere. Is enraged against us. Fleshly lusts war against our soul. People turn on worldly stuff and just feast on it. They just open up the channels of the television and just feast on sin to the max. Hell's box office. And on and on. And that stuff is just bathing their spirit, and they walk out of there, and the way they think is now programmed by some genius. And his name is Satan. To think different, to act different, to respond different. People become, what's going on in our world right now, and the way that kids are engrossed in these various different video games, and what they teach you how to do, your instincts to kill quickly without any remorse. I mean, come on, people. You're just feeding yourself. So I said, you mean I gotta give up video games? Listen, keep it if that's what you want. If that's the way you want to feel, it ain't gonna make you happy. If that's the way you want to live, if that's the way you want to think, if you want to be under that constantly, you mean I gotta give this up, I gotta give that up. Keep whatever you want. Keep it. The Lord's saying, would you like to be happy? Come over here. I know how to be happy, and I alone know how to be happy. Because you've been taken prisoner of sorrow and sadness. And let the redeemed of the Lord return and come to Zion with singing, and everlasting joy be on their head. They shall obtain gladness and joy. And sorrow and sighing, flee away. This is what Isaiah said, these things over and over again about what would happen when the Redeemer came. People, I just don't believe. You have the right to do that. You can do that. It's terrible not to believe when you got me smiling at you. When you got me, you got, you know, hundreds of thousands, millions of people smiling at you, walking in the goodness and the blessings of God. Oh, you're just lucky. Well, I'm going to tell you, my luck is centered around the fact that I called upon the name of Jesus and a million others did the same thing. Amen. So won't you get lucky too? Hallelujah. The Lord says, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. And people get all excited about prosper. When they, you know, monetize it and make it materialize. But actually, I got excited about soul prosperity. You mean I get to start looking at things for what they really are? God says, I want you to have wisdom. In other words, I want you to know what I know and see it the way it really is. But before you can ever do that, you've got to have truth, because he's going to establish truth in our inward parts that he may make us to know wisdom. You can't have wisdom without truth.
Amen.
Because all lies going to do is create for you a falsehood, a deception, a fantasy, something to deceive you. You believe it's right, but it's wrong. You're emotionally attached to your bad wrong. Huh? I watch, you know, being in this community of science, I watch people parade around with their ideas and so emotionally attached to it. And you can see that they're emotionally attached to their data because they get red-faced and start arguing about it. You're not emotionally attached. Huh? And then all of a sudden, what they believed was right is proven to be wrong. All of a sudden, their test tube blows up in their face, basically. Oops. The brightest of people are constantly trapped within the framework of a moving target and a guessing game. Huh? A charades with life. Huh? Guess again. Guess again. And the Lord says, no, no, no. I want to give you simple truth. I want you to love one another. All the time. But what if they're bad? I want you to love them. I want you to lay down your life for them. Let me show you what to do. Let me show you how redemption works. Let me show you how to get over into happy. I want to show you how to get over into love. I want to show you how to get over into goodness. I want to show you how to live in a place of purity where that all of a sudden sin and sickness and disease has no power over you. The blood actually broke it. The blood of Jesus actually broke the power of sin. It erased sin and broke the power and the authority of sin so that we can find ourselves continually walking in the Holy Ghost, living in the Holy Ghost, or the Spirit of God. You know, when you look in the Old Testament, you hear about people who had the Spirit of God upon them. They outshined everybody else. Daniel was seen to have the Spirit of God upon him. He was smarter than the smartest people of all the world, you know. I mean, come on. Over Joseph, he had the Spirit of God upon him. He was able to understand secret things and dreams and insights, had the knowledge of things that only God knew. Why, the Spirit of God, walking in the Spirit of God, shouldn't be something like, oh, you mean I got to give up video games? Wait a minute. Somehow, we're not even on the same page here. We're not even in the same universe over here. We're totally talking two different languages. You haven't seen the reality of life yet. And God wants to show you. And Jesus says, I'm the door. He said, if anybody wants to come in, come on in. I invite you to come in. He says, everyone that came before me is thieves and robbers. He says to us, he says, but I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. He says to us, the thief has come, but to kill and steal and destroy. And think about how many thieves you've allowed in your life in 2016. And are those thieves coming with you? No, come on, no. People. I'll tell you right now. Huh? This is like, you know, it's like just calling on heaven to just blow everything up and disseminate all of your enemy, because you're willing to step into this place where the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses, where the blood of Jesus Christ releases, where the power of God makes all things new. Behold, I make all things new. And it's not just one time. It's continually. It's continually. That's why in Israel, you like had 11 new, in the Israeli feast and the Jewish feast, biblical feast, you had like 11 new years that you celebrated. Because every new moon, you did the same thing you did at the first Passover, which is the beginning of years. You shouted and you the blast of the trumpet and the shout and the rejoicing before the Lord, that everything is new. He made it new once a month. How about new every day? How about wake up every morning? It's new. Oh, Lord, I'm ready to go on this adventure with you. I'm ready to learn how to cast out devils with more effectiveness. I'm ready to learn how to function in signs and wonders and miracles with more effectiveness. I'm ready, Lord, to learn how to live in a greater experience of joy unspeakable and full of glory. I'm ready to live in a greater experience of peace that passes understanding. I'm ready to learn how to let your peace rule my heart and my mind like never before. I'm ready to learn to walk with you like never before. I'm ready to walk with you like never before. I'm ready to see you. I'm ready to encounter you. I want some visions. I want some translations. I got a bigger vision today than I've ever had before. When you stop dreaming, you're dead. Something happened to you. Somebody messed you up. Somebody's tweaked the system. The big dreams, the visions in God. The pursuit, knowing that God is not a liar, that what he said is true, and you're going to lay hold on it. You've got all this evidence and got all this proof, and no, they're not lucky. They're not just lucky, you can be lucky too. Amen. They're not just lucky, they're blessed, and you can be blessed too. No, it didn't just happen by coincidence. It happened by an action of their will to agree with how God has purposed your life to be. And the Bible describes to us what God has decreed, what he has prophesied that your life is to be. Some people come to me and say, oh, so-and-so prophesied over me. Well, what? Big deal. God prophesied over you. I don't see a lot of that happening. Why are you so excited about somebody prophesied over you? How about all the things that God has prophesied over you, what he's decreed for your life? Why don't you get all like jumping up and down excited about that? Because it's far bigger than anything that anybody could ever prophesy over you, even if they told you that you were going to be the president of the United States or maybe even the emperor of the world. The Lord still prophesied something greater over you. Amen. He's made us his heir and co-inheritor with Jesus. He's opened a door before us that we may walk into the holies of holies and behold Father in all the fullness of his glory, walk into a life and a splendor that I get to live right now. I'm not waiting till I die. Some people say, oh, you know, these guys, they're all thinking about some, you know, pie in the sky, some place, you know, that they're going to go after that they die. No, I'm living in it now. Amen. I'm living in heaven now.
Hallelujah.
I'm living in heaven now. People choose to live in heaven now or live in hell. They do. People say, oh, well, if God's truly a God of love, he wouldn't send us to the big barbecue. We would be going to hell. No. You choose every day. You're so rude and unhappy and so obnoxious right now because you chose to be that way. You're so cantankerous and hard to live with. Huh? My goodness, people use makeup. My, if you just got happy and got a smile, you'd become times, 10 times more beautiful. Just because you got happy and had a smile, you become 10 times more beautiful. It does more for you than makeup could ever do. Makeup is made up. This would be genuinely real. Hallelujah. It's where God releases us to truly be who he created us to be, to truly be who we are. Hallelujah. No longer in a prison having to live out the dictates of some tyrant who's imposed upon us something that is not life at all. God calls it death. He calls it a living death. That's why people are so fascinated by the walking dead. I'm sure of it. I've never seen it. I have no desire to see it. I've seen the advertisements of it. You know, they got the Walking Dead toys. They got Walking Dead, all this stuff. So obviously, you know, people are really, you know, Hollywood doesn't produce what people aren't buying.
That's true.
Are you with me? Yeah. And where it did you, come on. Because people have an affinity towards that. How about the walking life? The walking alive? The living?
Yes.
Well, listen, we're going to step into a realm, and we are living in that realm, but we're going to step into a greater display of it, of His power and of His glory that releases people from their depression and their sorrow.
Yes.
Where suddenly they go, He's really there. He's really here. I feel something I've never felt before. Revelation chapter 21, let me just read this to you. Revelation chapter 21, just begin at verse 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. I'm going to tell you right now, the heaven He's already got is amazing. He's got a new design. He's planned out a new design with more splendor and more glory. This one, He says, there will never be any sin in it. Jesus' blood purified the heavens that now exist, and everything, He purified it. Everyone who participated, His blood was poured out for the sins of the whole world. But the whole world isn't willing to participate. My question to you: are you willing to participate? And just how far are you willing to go? Because what's going to happen is you're going to hit thresholds of where you're afraid to let go. Wait a minute, I got to rely on myself. No, I got to do this. No, what if I believe God and we die? What if we believe God and, you know, whatever, you know, we starve to death or whatever. There's going to be thresholds of the Lord saying, will you trust me?
Yeah.
And when you're young, and God make you young, even when you're old.
Amen.
He'll renew you. That's because He'll make you new. You'll make you young when you're old. You can mount up with wings. Huh?
Yeah.
As an eagle. You'll run and not be weary. Huh? I mean, He renews us. He renews us. Make us as... Huh?
Come on.
Paul said, though my outward man perishes, my inward man is made new every day.
Hallelujah.
Huh? My inward man is renewed continually. May constantly be made new. Huh? When you're young, you can just go with anything. Man, let's go. Yeah. I thought when I was like 16, let's just go to Australia and like take a bunch of that land in Australia. They say you can go and have it almost just for, you know, starting a cattle company out there. You don't even want to do anything. Who cares? Somebody says, what about this? What about this? It's like, what are you talking about? Who cares? Right?
That's right.
You get older, you start getting really conservative. You're afraid to go out the front door. The adventure is shut down. Huh? No way, man. That's getting old bad. That's getting bad old. The Lord just renews this. He says, listen, we go with me. He says to Abraham, 75 years old, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go with me to a place. I'm not going to tell you where we're going.
Yeah, that's cool.
Ha! And you got to leave everything mine. Man, he's well settled.
Okay.
He's well settled. 75 years old, you're well settled. I want you to leave everything behind. I want you to come with me because I'm going to give you an inheritance. I'm going to give you an inheritance. You're going to get me. I tell you, dear people, you stand in the presence of the Lord and that's going to be all that you want.
Amen.
So it's going to be all the one you want. Moses stood before the burning bush. He said, how are they going to believe? First of all, he's saying, I don't want to go because he doesn't want to move. He wants to stay right there with him. He said, I can't speak. Let me stay here. I can't talk. Let me stay here. Just give me a break. You can talk. I'll give you the ability to talk. He just loved the presence of the Lord. Huh? He said, well, I tell you what. He's like arguing with the Lord. He said, well, how are they going to believe that you sent me? He said, tell you what. Go tell him what I told you, then you can come back here and stand in front of me. He said, okay. Takes off. Well, that isn't a complete logical argument. Because I didn't do nothing for him while he was there. But it was answering his real question. He wants to stay in the presence of the Lord. He gets back, he's standing in the presence of the Lord. He says, no, I gotta have more. This is amazing. This is so good. This is life. Woo! This is it. This is the happy. This is the love. This is the goodness. This is every. I gotta have more. Let me see all of you and all of your glory. And the Lord saying, no, you'll die. He's like, he doesn't even hear die. Oh, please, I beg you, have mercy on me. Let me see more. He didn't even hear die. Die don't even matter. And that's why he says, listen, Lord, and the Lord's telling him about all that he's going to give him and all the inheritance that Israel's going to have in Canaan. And he's going, I want to stay here. You stay here? Are you staying here? Unless you go with us, I don't want to go. Are you staying here? Are you going? Because I want to stay here. That's what happens. That's what happens to every witness that has ever had an encounter with God. And you can have that encounter too.
Amen.
It's available.
Amen.
And in his presence, there's fullness of joy. You stay in his presence, you're going to be happy. That's the fruit of the Spirit. In other words, that's the evidence you're staying around the Holy Ghost. You're going to be happy. Somebody said, shouldn't we be sorrowful every once in a while so we don't look strange to the world around us? Look, you're strange already. Whether you're happy or sad, you're already strange. So forget about that.
Amen.
You're trying to please people, forget about that. We're talking about what you want, not what everybody else wants for you, what you want to prove to everybody about you. We're talking about what you want. You want to be happy.
Amen.
And his presence is happy. Somebody says, well, you know, how do we break free of having pleasure in unrighteousness? Stand in his presence where pleasures are forevermore. There's pleasures there that go far beyond anything that eating out of the trash can, which I like rather say, it's crude, but I like to say septic system. That's sin. That's iniquity. That's darkness. And that's where men have found their pleasures. They found their pleasures in abusing one another. They found their pleasures in taking someone else's wife and breaking the heart of all of their children and every relationship involved and the parents. They found their pleasure in murdering. They found their pleasure in hating. They found their pleasure in, hey, did you hear what sister so-and-so did? I can't even believe it. Can you believe it? They found their pleasure in talking evil about people. That's what men have found their pleasure in. They found their pleasure, men find their pleasure now because of the theater, in watching people die in hideous ways and watching things get exploded and blown up and chaos and mayhem and lust and iniquity. They love to watch demon spirits destroy another soul. That's why pornography is so big. That is actually a demon spirit at work destroying the soul of that individual.
Amen.
And people get their pleasure out of watching demon spirits destroy the soul of another person. It's true. It's true. Lord says, I want to bring you to another realm.
Amen.
I want to bring you to another realm. I want to bring you into a realm of life. I want to bring you into a realm of blessing. I want to bring you into a place of peace.
Yes.
Where you take no pleasure in unrighteousness anymore. You take no more pleasure in iniquity and wickedness anymore. You take pleasure rather in this realm of his goodness. You take pleasure in this realm of his world, his creation, all that he's done. And, you know, to try to begin to express that, I think we can a little bit. But Revelation chapter 21, I think, breaks it down a little bit better than I can describe it. Behold, I make a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth has passed away. Huh? Can I set you up with 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 there? If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. All things are new. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things are new and all things are of God. So here you're in a new heaven and new earth. If you step into that, you're not going to be thinking, well, I like the old one better. You're not going to say that for a second, because the old one has all of the poverty, all of the war, all of the famine, all the sin, all the strife, all of the hating, all the broken relationships, all of the iniquity. This one, there only dwells righteousness. There be sin no more. The old has passed away. How about you? Has the old passed away? Are you still reminiscing on bad memories, thinking about things of the past? Remembering something that was pleasurable for a season, but the end thereof was destruction and you're going back to it. Huh? Are you allowing God to change the way that you think by his word and by communion with him and by hanging out with him and by going on the adventure with him as he shows to us all that his hands have made and all that he's created for us, not only in the physical world, but what God has created for us in Christ Jesus to have in him as this on the relationship level. Huh? You can have all the money in the world, and if you're alone, you're sad and more miserable than anybody else. Because really what people want is lasting relationship. The data is in, the proofs are in. Sociological studies are done. But people don't know how to have relationships. Huh? It's like I heard a guy say the other day, remember what was, it was something, and he said, yeah, don't get married, find a woman that you're going to hate in 5 years and go ahead and give her your house. Should I say that again? Get married, don't get married. Find a woman that you're going to hate in 5 years and go ahead and give her your house. Because that's the way they think. That's the way their conclusions come down. Because what is happening is that's the statistics.
Yeah.
That marriages last about 5 years. And a lot of people aren't even getting married. And then the divorce settlement, you know, come on, are you with me?
Yeah.
Don't stand there and look at me like you know nothing about this. Because it's and if you don't, hello, it's happening all around you. And there's nobody who wants that. But man doesn't know how to do relationship. Because man doesn't know how to do love. Because man doesn't know how to do peace. They holler and scream and argue at one another. Hey, a yell's from hell. Shout to the Lord. Huh? Emotional poverty is worse than financial poverty. Emotional poverty is just screaming and hollering and upset. Nobody's ever living up to your standard because you're just miserable. You're miserable. And the Lord Jesus says, I've kind of set you free from your misery.
Amen. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
You talk about getting rich. As soon as you lost your misery, you just become extremely wealthy. You lost all misery, huh?
Yeah.
And wholeness and peace. Okay? You just got more than all the money in the world could not buy. The Lord says, behold, I make all things new. He says, and I saw a new heaven. Let me get this first. Let me back. I want to get ahead of myself. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. My former life has passed away. I'm living in heaven today. I want you to be able to walk out of here saying, my former life has ceased. I'm living as a son of God with the authority as a son. Christ Jesus is living in me. I'm living in him. The Spirit of the Lord has come upon me and lives on the inside of me, and the expressions of God flow out of me like rivers in unlimited, in respect to his unlimited supply. Come on now, come on. Look, you have to be willing to cooperate with that and agree with that. Otherwise, it's fictional Christianity. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Oh, really? Where? Don't pay any attention to the fact that I'm living in sadness and misery. Where are the evidence? Where's the evidence of love and joy and peace and goodness and long-suffering and gentleness and meekness and temperance and godliness? The evidence that I'm walking in this wonderful realm of life. And people, I'm going to tell you right now, until you're willing to step into this place, there's always going to be a gigantic void. And you'll fill it with something. And that's why there's people, and many people in God's kingdom, that are continually perpetual backsliders. They're continually going back to sin. They've never learned how to be filled with him. Jesus said, I'll give you to drink, and you'll never thirst again.
Amen.
And it'll be a wellspring springing up on the inside of you of the very life of God. His life, his love, his goodness, his joy. I want the salvation Jesus talked about. I'm not interested in the salvation that the preacher talks about if it's different from the salvation that Jesus talked. I'm not interested in the salvation that the theologian talks about if it's different from the salvation that Jesus presents. I heard an Orthodox rabbi arguing the other day with a person who was a Jew for Jesus. He said, I don't get you guys. He says, why do you want to be a Jew? Why don't you just want to be Jesus? He won the argument right there. As far as I was concerned, he won the argument. Good point. And then he argues from Paul. He says, you can't be a Jew and be Jesus. He says, it's another covenant. And he just blew the poor minister, Jewish minister, Jews for Jesus, completely away. And the guy was trying to regain his ground, blah, 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 blah. Listen, you know what? You're on the wrong foundation, mister. There's a new covenant. It's a new life. Listen, people think that somehow America's going to be better because Trump is president or new administration. Listen, if leadership, government could change people, Moses would have had the greatest group of folks on the planet. You know what I'm saying? Come on. Are you listening to me? Listen, we're looking for wrong things. And we say, oh, if I could just have that, I'll feel better. No, you won't. You'll feel worse. Because why will you feel worse? Because you thought now that if you had it, you'd feel better. But now that you've got it, now you don't have anything else to hope for. Now you've lost your hope because you don't feel any better. Now you feel worse because you've lost. You got what you thought was going to be your answer. And with it, you lost your hope. Can I get you to come to Jesus? A door is open before you. What is he asking you to do? He's asking you to agree with him. Why is that so difficult? Well, there's no logic to it. Because if there was any possibility of it being true, come on, a sane person would say, I'm taking hold of that. And that's why when we're in places in third world countries where, you know, they've not been indoctrinated by religion, people come by, they come running by the tens of thousands. They come running. They come running to Jesus. They've not been inoculated. They've not been inoculated with their arguments. Huh? With their secular humanism. With their religious ideas. They come running. And they meet Jesus. As real as the Lord is going to create a new heaven and a new earth, he wants to create a new you.
Amen.
Let me finish with this. You got to believe it. He created a new me. You say it's not true. Well, then you're going to have to argue with this data point right here. Here's proof. You're going to have to argue with this proof. I don't believe you. Well, fine. You can deny the evidence. You can say there's no sun either, but it's still going to come up.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he said, and he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. Come on. Come on. And he's not just talking about what he's going to do in the future. He's talking about what he's done right now. Behold, I make all things new. Behold, you get to come under my reign. Before the whole world lied in sin, the whole world was in prison to darkness and sin and iniquity. Jesus stepped in. God stepped in. We just celebrated it. The birth of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where God took upon the robes of sinful flesh. The whole world celebrated. To some degree, the whole world recognized. But he came for the single purpose of breaking the strongholds of sin and death, to take away the old, to release us from our prison so we could step in, no longer having to live out a life as all men had lived since Adam's sin and transgression, but where we could step into another realm to live out a heavenly life, to live a heavenly existence right now. To have our conversation in heaven, our lifestyle in heaven, our citizenship in heaven, to be seated in the heavenly realm, to be blessed with all blessings in the heavenly places, to walk in the Holy Ghost, to live in the Holy Ghost, to have Christ Jesus living in us, us living in him. To be privileged to sit down with him in his throne, to be seated together with him in the heavenly realm, to sit down with him in his throne, not another throne, his throne. What a place of authority. You want to break past your fears, your lies, your doubts, your unbelief? It's up to you. Let me just read this last part of this real quickly. He says, the former things are passed away. Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. He said to me, I am done. I am, he said unto me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is thirsty the fountain of water of life freely. He that overcomes shall inherit all things. I will be his God, and he shall be my son. And that's just something for the future. Just something for the right now. But there's got to be a willingness to hear that the cry of God that says, now that you've been given a new life, it's time to live a new life. Romans chapter 12, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Recognize that you're an entirely new creation. You're not part of this world system anymore. You belong in a heavenly realm now, not later, now. You're walking with me now. I'm your God now. You're my people now. He says, and don't be conformed to this world. There's that confirmation going on all the time, and people are wondering, why don't they have all that the Bible describes that they're supposed to be having? Because they're not obeying what God says to do. They're conforming to the world. They're allowing worldliness. They're allowing secularism. Oh, you mean I got to give up as the world turns? You mean I got to give up all this? And no. You're once again, you're completely in another universe. You're on a different page. We're not talking about you giving up anything. We're talking about you receiving and gaining life. We're talking about you getting released from your prison. You're saying your prison is something that you've got to give up. You're saying your problem is something that you've got to give up. Because you're addicted to a world that can give you nothing but sorrow and death.
Come on.
God wants to break the addiction.
Hallelujah.
God wants to break the addiction. You've come to rely upon, it's like Stalin said, let me show you how to rule people. He had his generals around him. He said, let me show you how to rule people. He grabbed a chicken. He plucked all the feathers off of the chicken. Set the chicken down. The chicken curled up, got close to, as close as it could, to his boot and stayed there. That's how you rule. Well, who did he learn that from? The prince of the power of the air, the God of this world. And that's the way Stalin ruled. And that's the way everybody ever rules. That's the way the governments work. That's what Satan does to you. You still feel like you got to give that up? Another plucking? Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the good news to the poor, to say, if you want to be happy, come here. I'll give you happiness. If you want love, come here. I'll give you love. If you want peace, come here. I'll give you peace. I'm here to bind up the broken in heart. Every place that your heart's been broken, every place that your heart has been ruined and destroyed, I'll give you a new heart. Talk about binding it up, a new one. To proclaim liberty to the captives. To release those who've been put into prison. Been in prison all your life. So the Lord said, don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured by having a new way of thinking. And King James translates it by the renewing of your mind. It's literally to think different. To think new. Amen. Why do you want to continue to think old? Why do you remember the problem? Why do you want to remember the offense? Why do you want to remember the failure? Why do you want to remember the things that were bad? Why don't you come over into the success and the good? Why do you want to remember your limitation when the Lord has opened the door for an unlimited experience in him of divine power and authority? So much so that you say to the mountain, be removed, cast into the sea, he's got to obey you. To where no more will you be brought into prison to sickness and disease. And of course, this just goes on and on and on and on and on. Because he says it over and over again. About this renewing, about this new thing, about this new creation, about this new relationship, about this new walk, about this new existence, about these new things. Then I just want to close with this. It's, you know, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, the Lord just really identifies it here. And we've got to deal with it because you can't blame God. You can't make new doctrines up that says, well, you know what God promised didn't come to pass in my life. or I've been after these things or believing for these things didn't happen. Wait, the reality of it is if you met the conditions of the covenant. In other words, if you want God's blessings, you're going to have to come all the way over to his new thing. You can't live in the old thing and have the new thing.
Amen.
You can't live in the old thing and believe the old thing and give yourself to the old thing and inherit the blessings of the new thing. You got to come on over here into this life. You can't, come on, you can't stay, go over there and fellowship with death and have all the fruits of life. Give me a break. So Paul simplifies it here, and he says simply this. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 16, he says to us, he says, I'm going to start at verse 14. He says to this, he says, don't be unequally yoked together with the unbeliever. He says, what fellowship had the righteous with the unrighteous?
Come on.
So therefore, he just told us that we are righteous. Yet there's a lot of people, they believe in the old. They believe in the old. They believe they're still unrighteous. They believe that they're sinners instead of saints. They believe that they're going to fail us to succeed. See, they're still living under the bondage of the old. You hear me? Huh?
Yes, sir.
Huh? They still, you know, the flu's coming around. I'm going to get sick. I'm the first one to get sick every time. No, you can take all the faith and you don't have to live in sickness anymore.
Amen.
You can take all the divine. You can take your problems and your sickness and your sorrow and your unforgiveness and your whatever in, you know, of 2016 and 2017 if you want. But God wants you to just erase that. He wants you to step in 2017 with everything being new.
Amen.
Clean slate.
Amen.
If someone comes to try to remind you something that happened in 2016, I don't remember. I'm not going to remember.
Amen.
And then you can learn how to do that every month. Then you can learn how to do that every week. Then you can learn how to do that every day. Then you can learn how to do that hour to hour.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on, man. I'm not playing. This isn't fictional. This isn't a fiction. This isn't a fiction. This is reality. This is provable, reproducible reality. He says, what communion has light with darkness? I'm light. I'm not dark. I'm light. Are you light? Light. He's the light of the world. He's made us the light of the world. Ye are the light of the world. I'm light over here. I'm not walking in darkness. I'm not walking in. Come on, man. Are you going to get into the new, or are you still going to believe that you're somehow in the old? That you got to try to earn what God freely gave you? Come on. We the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. It's what he's given to us. I never come on the basis of anything I am. He gave me the gift of righteousness, the gift of holiness, so that I can learn righteousness and learn holiness. I have a standing with God. It's imputed. It's imparted. It's ethical. It's relational. It's positional and experiential. It's all of the above. Come on. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Get on the new. Believe the new. He says one agreement has Christ with Belial. I'm over here in Christ Jesus. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. I'm over here. Jesus opens the door and says, come dwell in me. John chapter 15. Belial, Satan. You're in the one place. You're in one camp or the other. Light or darkness, Christ is your king or Belial is. Christ your ruler or Satan is your ruler. Period. I'm my own ruler. Oh, you are. And that's what's like to live in your kingdom? That's what you've decreed over yourself? Give me a break. You don't believe that for 1 minute. And if you do, it's wrong. You're wrong. Because you would be decreeing over yourself riches and happiness and friends and fame and, you know, right? He says to us, I hope God's making sense to you here.
Amen.
Hope God makes sense.
Yes.
Hope his life makes sense. And you can prove it and see. Taste and see. The Lord says, come take a taste. Yeah. Oh, I don't like that. Well, why don't you just taste it? Well, I'm not sure I want it. Well, just taste. I tell you, you're going to go, whoa, this is the best stuff I've ever had. This is the best, hey, Paul? This is the best stuff we've ever had. He says, what agreement has the temple of God with idols? Make sure you don't allow any idols into your life this year. You know, I love the reset button of the new year of fasting and praying. And I've just really started saying, okay, I'm going to bring everybody into this. Because What happens is you can settle out if you're not careful. You can settle out. You can actually allow things or compromises. You know, then almost you don't even recognize it. You could. But then you just basically give yourself to fasting and praying, and it's just like the total reset button. You're going, wait a minute. I'm not going to condescend to that thing. Wait. What did we made an agreement with sickness? We're going to kill it right now. We're going to be reminded of our authority and our place in the kingdom of God. Well, we made an agreement with retiring early. You know, I recently just said, I'm going to give away everything that God's blessed me with. And he's richly blessed me. I'm going to give everything away. But I'm going to give it away. But I'm not half done. Watch what happens now. Now we get it all away. Give it away. Now watch this. I mean, come on, I'm turning 58. It's time to kick it into gear.
Yeah, that's right. Come on.
It's time to kick it in. Oh, well, you're lucky. Well, you can be lucky too.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. People want to make excuses. This excuse, that excuse. This is why it's not so. This is why I can't have it. Society is the one that determines what I can have and can't have. You want to live like that? The society, that your caste system, that the people around you, that your government determines how you can live and how you can't live? You want to live like that? That's not freedom. The Lord's come to give us freedom. Liberation. There's no liberty outside of him, no freedom outside of him. If you believe that, you're going to be under that. But I don't believe that. The Lord decides everything about my life. Huh? No, I'm pretty radical about this. I'm pretty radical. Don't do what I do, but I'm just going to tell you. I mean, like everybody, we were coming through the snow pass the other night, and people are just off the side of the road. Some people stop in the middle of the road. I'm wide open. I have no fear nor concern because I'm under the protection of Almighty God. Nobody's going to get hurt by me, and I'm not going to get hurt by anything.
That's right.
And when the Lord says it's time for me to go, I'll go. That's why I have no problem going to Kashmir or going to other places that are war zones. No problem.
That's right.
Papa's in charge.
Amen.
I'm good.
Amen.
It's like one man said, I feel as safe on the battlefield as I do in bed. Because Almighty God is sovereign, has sovereign control over my life. Have you given him sovereign control over your life? Tonight, today, at this moment in time, the Lord wants you to choose, let him be your God. Listen to this. He says, and what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. Wow. Try to stop me. God's here. Almighty God's here. Try to mess with me. Preachers running around with guns. I'm like, that's so pathetic. What are you going to do with that thing? Can you even hit what you aim at? And besides that, you only need that against somebody who's going to kill you in the first 2 seconds. So are you willing to kill in the first second? Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Then I try to tell him, man, I've been in the big middle of places where gang fights are going down. And just, I've had people just come at me, like just out of prison, come at me with all of their stuff. I didn't need a gun.
Amen.
I have the Son.
Yeah. Amen.
I have the power, the authority of the living God. I can speak peace to the storm. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, people. Are you going to come all the way into the new, or are you going to come halfway over to the new? Is God going to protect you half the time? You're going to protect yourself the other half the time? God's going to provide for you half the time? You're going to provide for yourself half the time? God's going to redeem you half the time? You're going to redeem yourself the half the time? What is it? How you divide this up between him and him? You and him. What is God? How does God got to be different so you'll like him more? What does he need to change so that you'll feel better about him? Think of that. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Minister de Suprata say. You know, it's just thinking of Ed Boy. He carries a tambourine everywhere he goes. He's become one of the most prestigious men in the church across the world. Somebody who had no shoes.
Yes.
Had no shoes. In Nigeria, in a very poor community, from a very poor family. Now he's before the presidents and the kings. He's the head man.
Yes.
He carries a tamarind ring with him. People say, why do you carry a tamarind ring with you? Because I'm always ready to worship.
Amen.
See, he's living in heaven. Come on, think about it, people. Think about it. Where pride and arrogance and all this wanting to please men and, you know, come on, sits in. Ooh, come on. Let's make a transition into heaven. Let's quit living in the earthly realm. Let's go ahead and take a hold of what God has given us an opportunity to be a part of. That we're no longer a part of this darkness, but been translated into the kingdom of the dear Son. Let's go ahead and be a part of what God has given us the opportunity to do, to step through the door of Christ Jesus into a whole nother realm called the heavenly.
Amen.
Let's go ahead and be the temple of the living God. Yes. Let's go ahead and be the place where God dwells. He says, I will dwell in them. This is what the Lord says. This is the new thing. He says, I will dwell in them. I will walk in them. That's what's happened in my life. He dwells in me. He's walking in me. Wow. You can say whatever you want to say about it from your perspective. Doesn't change it at all for me. He lives in me. He dwells in me. We're inviting you to allow him to live in you and dwell in you. He says, and here's the thing. He says, come out from among them and be separate. And people are thinking, well, you know, I've got to give things up. No. They are going to pollute your thinking.
That's right.
They are going to pull you over into a realm of darkness, of doubt and unbelief and sorrow and sadness. And the Lord says, come out from among them. Come over here into this life. Get out of the death. Get out of the darkness. Get out of the unrighteousness. Get out of the servitude to the realms of Satan. Get out of all of your covetousness and idolatry. Come over here, you, the temple of God. Be separate, the Lord says,
amen,
to you and me. And he says, and touch not the unclean thing.
Come on.
And I will receive you. And I will be father to you. Wow. If I was sitting in the big middle of all the gold and diamonds and riches of the world, and I had God looking at me saying, come here and I'll be your father. But leave that. I'm going to jump up and run. Unless I let my heart become attached to it. So the Lord says, okay, I'll tell you what I do. Your heart's messed up. It's attached to that stuff. I'm going to give you a new heart.
Amen.
That don't have attachments to that stuff. Isn't he amazing? Your spirit's all tweaked and twisted. And you don't understand. The knowledge that you have is causing you to think wrong. I'm going to give you a new spirit. So that we will jump up. And leave everything behind. And no longer have our desire in that which is seen. No longer having a desire in the for the things that are seen. But our desire now, or we look upon, or we desire, or we look to that which is unseen. For that which is seen is just temporal.
Yes.
Perishes with the using. Just really a realm of death. This is Paul's doctrine. Mm-hmm. But that which is unseen, that's eternal. And there's where life and peace is. Here's where life and peace is. And God's saying, listen, Father has chosen to, as it were, just to remain in the invisible realm, but he doesn't stay there. He makes himself visible in many ways. With his acts of love and power and glory. And as Jesus said, you obey me and you walk with me, I'll come and I'll manifest myself to you. I'll come and reveal myself. Because that realm of the unseen right now is as real as a real realm. It's more real than this realm right here, because that's eternal, this is temporal. And it can be seen and it can be beheld. And the Lord just inviting us to start off with, just come, be made new. Because that's bigger than all the external factors. Having a new heart, a new attitude, a new disposition is bigger than all the external factors. Being changed from within is bigger than all the external factors. Everybody stand with me, please. He who are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. The Lord Jesus, He invites you and I to come into the realm in which He lives, the realm of heaven, the realm called heaven, the realm where Father reigns forevermore in His life and His goodness, a realm where darkness cannot come, where Satan has lost all his power, where you and I are no longer just in a human condition, but are sons and daughters of the Most High. This day is the day of redemption. Today is the day of salvation, of deliverance, of your release from all of the things that belong to sin, its death, its iniquity. Will you just respond to God in His love and His goodness? Would you cry out to Christ Jesus and say to Him, come, release me, come, deliver me. I don't want to live in this world of sorrow. I don't want to live in this world of sin and iniquity anymore. If you will, He'll come and make all things new for you right now. Christ Jesus wants to make all things new for you right now. And for those of you who've been walking with the Lord, He wants to cause you to understand how to truly embrace all that He has made new and agree with Him, and no longer have the old. Let it be passed away. Let it no longer exist. Let it no longer have power or influence in your life. Don't be conformed to the world. Shut the world out. Shut the darkness out, so that you can begin to learn about the glories of His life and the goodness of relationship with Him. Let's step into a place with the Father where His light of His love begins to shine with such brightness that all the world begins to see it like they've never seen it before. Thank you, Jesus. Father's made it so simple. Made it all so simple. The gift for the asking. You are the Almighty, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Thank you for the change that comes into your people's lives right now, that causes the people of the abiding place and the people that are standing in here right now to see the beauty and the splendor of living their life in you and with you. Father, we thank you that the darkness is past. that this new day has come. And that there would not be a single person under the sound of our voice that would refuse to surrender their life to you. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. There's no reason for anybody here to leave this day with sorrow and sadness and sickness and sin. There's no reason. There's no reason. If you leave here today with sorrow and sadness and sickness, it is because somehow you were unwilling to receive what the Lord has supplied. Don't do it ever again. Don't do it today. Maybe some of you are in the throes with some kind of sickness or disease and you've been believing God for healing. Listen, go ahead and get a breakthrough. Because He's already decreed it. He's already decreed it. See, He's already decreed it. Stop living under the influences of things that He did not decree. Stop being influenced by the lie, the fear, the doubt, and the deception. Stop it right now. Agree with God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We want you to prepare an offering for the Lord. The offering of your heart. The offering of your heart. Consecration of your life. Somebody says, why do we receive offerings? Because the Lord commanded us to. That's it. And because in that commandment, He promised that He would work a miracle through the act of obedience, to the act of placing His business and your trust in His business above everything else. He said, I'll multiply everything that you sow. He said, I'll cause increase to come to you abundantly beyond all that you could think or ask. That's His purpose for our lives. He calls all grace to abound to us, that we'll have all sufficiency in all things. And, you know, that's why even when we're in very poor countries, among very poor people, we're encouraging them to come and give the Lord an offering because we know what God's going to do through it. He's going to work a miracle of provision through their willingness to participate with that miracle. By acts of obedience. By acts of just trusting God. Amen. So what I want you to do is you're preparing an offering right now, I want you to also prepare your heart to go around and hug everybody in the place. People say they want to walk in greater love. You know what? You need to give yourself more to love. And over again, I find out that there's not a lot of people in this place that really go around and hug everyone. There's not a lot of folks that are obedient. Because only two or three people come and hug me. So there's only really two or three people in the place that are really truly obedient. And I say that because if you're going to have what God has supplied, you've got to participate with it. People don't go hug because of fear and intimidation. They don't go hug people because, listen, I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. You don't go hug people because of fear dominating your life and intimidation dominating your life. It's not anything other than that. And it's holding you back from all that God has supplied in His realm of life. Don't be the same in 2017 as you've been in 2016. Don't be the same today as you were yesterday. There's growth for you. And it's going to come your way because you're going to be willing to obey God and agree with His new thing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You're not going to think in the former way. You're going to think in His way. You're not going to think in the old way. You're going to think in the new way. The Lord has set an open door before you. But you have to come in. He said, no, you can sit there and you can stand there and go, wow, I believe in the open door. Look at the open door. The open door is beautiful. My, it's an amazing open door. Wow. And have all the right doctrines about the open door. But you've got to walk in. And when you walk in, whew, hallelujah. You don't want to walk out. Amen. So we're come worship the Lord. Find everybody in the house. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. If there's anybody that wants prayer for anything, come. We'll pray with you and for you. We know the Lord will touch you.
I love you so much.
We know the Lord will touch you, heal you. Hallelujah. Thank you.